Toronto's Institute's third public lecture on the topic of human rights education from the courtroom to the streets, a concern with the broad socialization of human rights norms. We are very, very happy to have, after lots of negotiations and coordination, I think it was 7 months, that we waited for Professor Gudmundur Alfredsson, because we thought that there's no one, there's no better person to talk about the subject of human rights education as a human right. And I will tell you why we chose and waited patiently for Professor Gudmundur Alfredsson to turn up in Budapest. I met with Professor Alfredsson in 91 at the UN when I started lobbying for the rights of Hungarian minorities, myself being Hungarian from Romania. And it was Professor Alfredsson who gave me the first and explained to me the first international instruments on minority rights. And he sat on the International Board of Minority Rights Group International. Then he built up the Raoul Wallenberg Institute in Lund, the human rights institution in Lund, to what it is today. Gudmundur Alfredsson, I'm looking at your CV, Gudmundur, because it's even the short one is very rich, the short version is very rich. Gudmundur is an Icelandic lawyer, and he worked, his first work was on green land and the right to external self-determination, his doctoral dissertation, and I think that set the ground for Gudmundur's further work, because he's been involved in practically all in the making of practically all international norms on minority rights and indigenous rights as a secretary to the Working Group on Indigenous Populations in the UN, as a secretary to the Working Group concerned with the making of the 92 UN Declaration on minorities, and later on while director at of the Raoul Wallenberg Institute for Human Rights in Lund. He was the one who convened the expert group that conceptualized the very well-known Lund recommendations. This is why Lund recommendations on the political participation of national minorities. Gudmundur, I found out yesterday that Gudmundur was just appointed as a professor in Beijing. Gudmundur would carry out human rights education in China quite regularly. He is editor-in-chief of the International Journal on Minority and Group Rights, indeed founder of the only international journal addressing specifically minority rights. He is also co-editor-in-chief of the Yearbook of Polar Law. You can ask him about this concept of polar law. And he's also member of the advisory board of the Arctic Circle. And Gudmundur has lectured and visited more than 200 countries, and I know that he will go to Micronesia next. Right, in the Pacific, I think. So there are a few countries Professor Gudmundur did not visit and teach at. So he has extremely broad experience about human rights education, and also an overview of where human rights as norms, as guiding norms, stand today. And now I will give the word to Professor Gugubo Alfred. So thank you.
Thank you, Anna Maria, for this introduction, far too long and far too kind. Good morning to all of you. The topic today is human rights education, and I will look a little bit at the international instruments and national activities we have ongoing in this field, look at the contents and actors and audiences and monitoring of human rights education that we have at international and national levels today, and in the end maybe make some recommendations on where to go from here. Not so long ago, in December 2011, the General Assembly of the UN adopted a declaration on human rights education and training. It's been negotiated for a few years. It was adopted without a vote. It's short, 8 preambular paragraphs and 14 articles, but on some of the issues I mentioned, it does have considerable detail. It's not a known instrument, unfortunately. I haven't seen much coverage of it. Have any of you heard of this declaration? Not really. And that's a pity, because the whole idea of this declaration is that university audiences and other teacher communities would react to it and follow up on its provisions. But the declaration from 2011 is not the first international instrument to prescribe human rights education. Already when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted in 1948, in the same resolution accompanying Universal Declaration, there was another resolution, 217D, saying that member states should give publicity to the declaration and introduce the teaching of the declaration in all educational institutions. So the idea is not new, but it has lingered without too much attention for a long time. You have references to human rights education also in the Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, in the Convention on the Rights of the Child, in the specialized conventions on racial discrimination and against discrimination of women, and a number of other instruments. You have world declarations like the Social Summit outcome, calling for human rights education. UN had human rights education decades. Currently there is in place a world program on human rights education. It's in its third phase. Again, not many people have heard about it. Part of the problem is, of course, the UN is not devoting too many resources or funding to these issues. But I think we have come that far, that with references not least to the widely ratified treaties, followed up by the declaration from 2011 and a number of other references, together with increased practice in a number of states, that we now can say there is a right to human rights education. We all have the right to be educated in human rights. Unfortunately, there is not much we can do to pursue it. The monitoring is largely missing, but I'll come back to that later. Human rights education is tremendously important. If you look at the world today, if human rights is a success story, and by and large over the last few decades, human rights has been very successful. It's made a lot of difference in a lot of places. Doesn't mean there haven't been setbacks, there continue to be setbacks, but overall it has been a move forward. And the main reason for that is popular support. It's not the government, Some of them play along. But the reason for the success of human rights is that people want human rights for themselves. No matter where I've gone in this world talking human rights, also in countries where human rights may not be on the public agenda, people want these rights for themselves, and they are increasingly willing and able to stand up and say it. People need to know what their rights are in order to pursue them. They also need to know what legal methods and avenues and political methods and avenues are in place for them to pursue these rights. We need to educate or train officials at all levels, not least judges, prosecutors, police, others involved in law enforcement, about what human rights are, because you can hardly expect them to respect these rights until they know them. So human rights education is tremendously important at many levels. So I mentioned the 2011 declaration. It's now a sort of master summary of what needs to be and should be done in this field. It is not very long. It has some interesting details. It has some unfortunate shortcomings. But if you look briefly at the contents, the actors, the audiences, and the methods for implementation, we can say the following. The contents of human rights education, according to the declaration, should very much be the international standards that have been adopted in the international organizations. There should also be references to national standards, bills of rights, and what have you. But the common denominator should be the international standards. That is the road towards creating the universality of human rights, the universal culture of human rights. In addition to human rights, the declaration specifically refers to humanitarian law, rule of law, tolerance, peace, development, democracy, social justice, and by extension, you can say that human rights education should extend to these closely related fields of refugee law, international labor standards, intellectual property rights, corporate social responsibility, good governance and non-corruption, and international criminal law. All these are today very much part and parcel of the overall human rights picture we are looking at. As to the basics of human rights, the declaration refers to equal rights and non-discrimination. Unfortunately, it is short on the special measures that many of the instruments call for in order to achieve equal rights through the elimination of racial discrimination. And indeed, the declaration is very short on the rights of vulnerable groups, including minorities and indigenous peoples. The ever-present reluctance of governments to address these issues seriously has also found its way into the drafting of the 2011 declaration. The contents should include civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights. And indeed, the declaration and the preparatory work for the debates leading to the adoption of the declaration are quite interestingly open in terms of the issues to be addressed, from freedom of expression to participation in economic and political life to social security to education and so on. And human rights are not worth much if there are no remedies, and the declaration does repeat more or less the language of Article 2 of the Covenant of Civil and Political Rights. There shall be remedies, there shall be access to courts, there shall be access to national human rights institutions, and other means in place for the realization of the rights, and that should be part of the education effort. People should know not only what rights they have, but also how to pursue them. in terms of actors and audiences, the declaration refers to schools at all levels, public and private schools, and basically from kindergarten to university and adult education. Special emphasis is placed on professional training for the groups I mentioned before, the judiciary, the prosecutors, attorneys at law, police, prison officials, militaries. All of these are spelled out as target groups in the declaration. And the role of national human rights institutions is also underlined in terms of education and awareness raising. NGOs and academic institutions are also listed, and I'm very happy to see that Tom Lantos Institute has now human rights education on their agenda, and there is certainly plenty of work that you could and should be undertaking in that respect. A number of countries now have these types of institutes. Ana Maria mentioned I worked for some 12 years with the Raoul Wallenberg Institute in Sweden. It's affiliated with the University of Lund. It has a budget today of about $10 million. It runs human rights teaching and training activities in some 50 countries. It has a master program in Sweden and affiliated with master programs in other countries from China to Turkey and you name it. What institutes can do is plenty. And it was my experience with Raoul Wallenberg Institute. Whatever you do in the field of human rights, what is politically least controversial and what is easiest to raise funds for is indeed human rights education and training. Nobody can be against it. Even reluctant governments go along with human rights education and training. So there are possibilities. And I would suggest also your institute could strike up collaboration deals with some of these existing institutes with a lot of experience in this field. Not only the Institute in Lund, but you have the Danish Center for Human Rights in Copenhagen, you have the Oslo Institute of Human Rights, you have the Irish Institute in Galway, the Dutch Institute in Utrecht, and so on and so on. There is many of these ongoing activities and going strong. The human rights education, yes, it should start in kindergarten. I was telling Ana Maria yesterday, I have a 4-year-old son. They live in France. He is learning human rights in maternelle or kindergarten. He is learning what they call ethics in the French school system, and it includes dignity, tolerance, equal rights, non-discrimination. I was very impressed when I was looking through his materials. And I wish as many countries as possible would follow this lead, and I do think indeed it is missing in a lot of countries. And it should extend to universities. Today we do have some 60 universities, by my rough counting, that offer human rights degree programs, master and PhD programs. Still a drop in the ocean, but if you keep in mind that the oldest of these programs is only about 25 years old, the University of Essex in England was the first to start. That's not very long ago. We are talking about a fairly recent development that has taken off quite rapidly. And I think it is still growing. As a result, we are having a new human rights profession. We are having maybe 2,000-3,000 graduates specialized in human rights every year. It's going to be tens of thousands of people before you know. And I think that's very, very important for human rights, that you have these people with specialized knowledge. Still a drop in the ocean you need. A lot more people. In addition to these universities on all continents now offering degree programs, thousands of other universities offer courses in human rights in different academic disciplines without going all the way towards offering degrees. Ana Maria mentioned that I've been teaching in China. Indeed, I've been teaching in two human rights master programs in China, at the University of Beijing and at the China University of Political Science and Law. They are a few years old. They teach human rights as we know them. There is no government or party manipulation. And the Chinese academics teaching in these programs are remarkably good, and the students are asking about one-party systems and torture and Tibet. And, well, hey, there is freedom of speech in the classroom. And that's a tremendous change over a period of 10 or 20 years. I started going to China 22 years ago, and in the last 2 years, human rights education in a very serious manner has taken off, and one hopes that in the long run that can also make a difference on the governance in that country, and indeed they have some human rights problems. That's not to be denied. But this education effort I find very encouraging. And if we can do it in China, I think we can do it in most other countries as well. It is not enough in my mind that you teach human rights in law schools only. Most of the degree programs I was referring to are at law faculties or law schools. You need to teach human rights in most departments or faculties of a university. Lawyers are never going to introduce alone that universal culture of human rights. You need other disciplines to engage in that process as well. And I was working, I was on a committee in the University of Lund in Sweden. We were setting up an interdisciplinary master. And we went through the catalogue of Lund University, and it's a big university with over 40,000 students, and practically all disciplines are taught. And human rights have relevance to most of the topics taught in a university. You have, I wrote a list here somewhere, human rights and anthropology, way of life as cultural rights, customary law, traditional criminal justice, what have you, biology and genetics, chemistry, the right to health, the environment, chemical weapons, geography, composition of populations, kin states, borders, history, obvious connection, engineering and architecture, access for disabled persons, number of issues, journalism, tremendously crucial for human rights, that the journalists bring up the right issues and come up with some of the proper answers. And you'll be interested, if you open a newspaper today, human rights pops up quite a lot, or human rights related stories. Unfortunately, the references to international standards and the commitments of governments are missing because the journalists haven't been educated in it, but the connections are there. Mathematics, they also, mathematicians need to learn human rights. They are in turn in charge of statistics. And if you want to have good statistics, you have to know what questions to ask. Medicine and nursing, obvious, philosophy, political science, sociology, psychology, teaching colleges. If you want to teach human rights in elementary schools and secondary schools and colleges and what have you, we need a teaching course that is available to teach human rights at all these different levels. Theology. Basically, every department in a university setting has relevance with human rights. And you should introduce human rights in all of these faculties and departments before you succeed in asserting that universal culture. And in the law school, in my mind, it is very unsatisfactory to have a separate human rights program and teach human rights as separate courses. you need to integrate or mainstream human rights in law schools just as you would have to do it on the university level as a whole. Again, I wrote down a list. Human rights are relevant to plenty of topics in law school, not only international law, constitutional law, administrative law, civil procedure, corporation law, human rights and business, criminal procedure, criminal law, family law, inheritance law, labor law, media law, environmental law, property law, taxation law, torts, compensation law. Everywhere, in all of these subjects, human rights should be present. And I lectured to my fellow law professors in Lund, Sweden, saying you should introduce human rights in all of your various subjects, and they grunted back. They did not like it. And the resistance to this type of change, both at the university level and at the law school level, is going to be the old professors who don't want to learn new things. All the more important to teach the young ones how to proceed and deal with it in the future. I'm talking too long. Methods and materials. There's plenty of human rights textbooks and materials available for some of the issues and some of the audiences we have been referring to. For law schools, for some other university departments, you will find textbooks in human rights. You will find much less availability of good textbooks at other school levels. Some countries have done it, and what one would need, some institution to take the lead and being a clearinghouse, collecting these textbooks. They don't have to be written again and again in different countries. You can often translate or adapt from one country to another. There is one excellent NGO that both produces and collects human rights teaching materials, REA, the Human Rights Education Association. The website is www.hrea.org. They have an impressive collection in multiple languages as well, and they are generous in distributing it. And a number of other organizations, both intergovernmental and non-governmental, have produced teaching materials on the websites of the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, on the website of the Council of Europe. You do find some textbooks for different school levels as well. And you need legislation. If you want to reach public and private schools at all levels, countries need national legislation on human rights education. And preferably this legislation in line with the 2011 declaration would spell out some of the contents, make sure that this education effort follows the lines of international standards adopted with national exploration as well, but this has to be in place. And finally, a few concluding remarks. It's good to have a declaration, but this is a topic where we should have a treaty. I see no reason why the UN shouldn't go ahead and draft a convention on human rights education and training. I think it's even politically feasible. Governments would go along with it, and a treaty would be that much more enforceable and monitorable at both international and national level. Number two, I mentioned it already, put together a clearinghouse, an institution that is willing and able to collect teaching materials on human rights at all the different school levels and for the different audiences. I was in New Zealand. They have excellent textbooks on human rights for primary schools. I think they could be used in a lot of different countries. It doesn't always have to be the wheel reinvented. Some of it could be done through translation. In China, my institute in Sweden was working with the National Prosecutorial College of China. They only have 150,000 prosecutors, so it's a pretty big group that you need to educate. Numbers in China tend to be on the high side. And we drafted with them a manual on human rights for prosecutors. I think it's a perfectly respectable publication and can be used. Human rights manuals for police have been done by Amnesty International and other organizations. So you have the scattering of these materials all over, but no real systematic collection of what is available and existing. Somebody needs to do it. Rare, the NGO comes a long way, but it's not complete. Number three, and that's maybe because of my own specialization, I have been working a lot in my career on the issues of minority rights and indigenous rights. I find the declaration very inadequate when it comes to these two categories of rights. In terms of teaching majorities about minority rights and teaching minorities about what rights they have and the avenues of redress and doing it in their own language and so on. This is missing. And number four, and finally, the declaration is totally silent on monitoring. It's very nice to have standards, it's very nice to have code books, but if they do not have follow-up in terms of national or international monitoring, action is going to be insufficient. Governments and the schools need to have their ass kicked. That's the experience with other human rights, and I think human rights education is no different. A treaty on human rights education and training could be one vehicle for strengthening and working more on monitoring, but we also have monitoring in the UN for human rights for declarations. It doesn't have to be on the basis of treaties. And I think the Human Rights Council should proceed with setting up a monitoring body for human rights education. And I was thinking that would be a different monitoring body. Usually the special rapporteurs or working groups doing monitoring of declarations in the UN, they look for violations, they look for problems. I think it would be nice to have a special rapporteur for Working Group on Human Rights Education that would look for success stories, collect information about where human rights are being taught, where it is being done well, where it is the textbooks and teaching materials available and so on. Maybe that could also be the role of the clearinghouse. And I spoke longer than Anna Maria told me to speak. She also told me that it's time for questions and answers, and I remain in your hands. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gudmundur, for the overview you have given. I will open the floor for questions now. As you heard, Gudmundur has a tremendous experience in minority and indigenous rights, I'm sure he will be happy to answer questions on that specific topic as well. Please.
How do you assess the impact of human rights education? I mean, what is the methodology or the practice? It would seem to me that, so you mentioned that when we came to Dominari and then got indigenous rights, there was no built-in or monitoring process. And it seems to me that it's meaningless, but without that. So I'd just be interested in your reflection on that.
Assessing and measuring the quality and success of other forms of education. You look at the teachers, you look at the teaching materials, you look at the students, you know, the students evaluate, you have measurement like where and how are they employed sometime later. And there's another thing I could have mentioned. The experience of all these human rights master programs that we now have in the world has been, and we did formal surveys in Sweden, the graduates are finding human rights jobs. The biggest employers of these human rights graduates are governments, various agencies in government, from ministries to national human rights institutions to courts and prosecutors and so on. The second biggest employer was NGOs. Some very big NGO human rights employers out there, both international and national NGOs. The third biggest employer was academia or research institutions, followed by international organizations. And don't forget, the employment opportunities at IGOs, the intergovernmental organizations, has multiplied in recent years. When I left the UN Office of Human Rights in 1995, we were 150 staff members. Today, the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights has over 1,100 staff members, multiplied. And the same is true for a number of other international organizations. So there is a market there. These recruiting institutions more and more are demanding in job descriptions that people have this specialized education in human rights. So they think it makes a difference. But your question otherwise is very difficult. Measuring progress is difficult here, and it's going to take time. You almost have to look at a generation before you see what results come in. I'm very happy to report that one of my students from Lund is now the Minister of Justice of Indonesia. Another one of my students is Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs in China. You see these graduates slowly moving up the ladder of influence in their countries. I'm not saying they are doing everything the education should have indicated to them, but at least it's good to have people in these positions who know the standards and might be willing and able to do the right thing somewhere down the road. But I don't think I can give you a more concrete answer than that.
Could you please mention other examples, especially on lower school levels?
It happens, we are sometimes taken to visit lower school levels, and I remember in particular in New Zealand that they had trained teachers in human rights and produced textbooks, illustrated textbooks with practical examples and real-life examples of human rights for elementary schools, and I found it enjoyable to read. In Sweden, there is now an interdisciplinary master program for teaching teachers to teach human rights in elementary schools and secondary schools. And I think that's also a very important first step in terms of having human rights education spread at other school levels. And I'm sure you can find examples in a number of other countries. I mentioned France. My little son, at age of four, beginning to have human rights education. I thought that was very impressive, not least when I looked at the contents of it. I don't know if it's consistently done throughout other French schools, but it will be an interesting study, subject of study, if any of you are looking for thesis topics or research proposals, do that survey. It would be very interesting to have.
My name is Valery Novoselsky, and I'm the editor of Roma Virtual Network. Actually, my question to you relates with your activities in China. Very specific question. Did you find it practically possible and important to apply the human rights education in East Turkestan or Xinjiang? I mean, what special can you tell about the human rights education in the area where you Uyghurs are populated? Was it possible, not, and what challenges did it face? It has something in common with Tibet issue, and at the same time, it has some differences.
our partner for that has been the Ethnic Affairs University and Ethnic Affairs Commission, and there have been representatives from different minority groups, Uyghurs, coming to Beijing for attending these lessons. But we have never had direct contact with the Uyghurs as an organization or as a people or as a group. We have had more contact with Tibet, and we have had more contact with a number of other minorities living in more central places in China. The Chinese authorities tell us, if you want to go to Uyghur, you can go. But I mean, China is a big country and we have not been able to cover every part of it so far.
Hungarian Business Leaders Forum, we are covering a program which is called Romaster. This is focusing on the Roma issue in Hungary, and I think it's becoming more and more a European issue since 5 to 10 million Romas are around in Europe, and in Hungary definitely this is the largest badly affected minority. I think teaching is extremely important. Teachers, to teach the teachers and train the trainers. What would you suggest to reach the minorities themselves? I mean, what are the means you would think that human rights to learn for the minorities would be the best method? And not only through the teaching, through teachers, but do you have other issues how to make this human rights on a broader scale?
We do through national, local counterparts. When we can find minority NGOs or minority organizations, we approach those. We approach general human rights NGOs because they often have contacts into the same community. What we refrain from is asking governments to find minority representatives because they may not find people who are the most representative type group we would want to reach. At the same time, some of the most successful minority rights training I've engaged in has been when minority people and government people are in the same room. Train them together. Because very often minorities and government people don't much know each other. Their concerns, their thinking on both sides, their problems. And I find, it's not only the minority or the training classroom, it's the breakfast break, it's the lunch break, it's the dinner break when you put them together and they start talking. I think that's a very important part as well. But it's never been a problem to find good minority people to train if you reach out in this way. The master of ceremonies I ever saw in operation in this respect was Max van der Stoel, the former OSCE High Commissioner on National Minorities. They did a lot of training as well. And his point of view was always, let's take them to some remote hotels where the government people cannot run back to the capital at night. And then he would walk around the room and systematically make sure that the lunch and dinner tables were mixed and encourage discussion. And I think that's a very good model, and I agree with you, this minority rights training is very important, because just like with human rights in general, minority rights are not going to be fully successful or operational until the rights holders, the beneficiaries themselves, know what rights they have and how to ask for them and where to go after them.
Human rights education and cultural norms and traditions. So what would you recommend in points where the two of them clash, where you're trying to do something in a community, but then the people say this is not our tradition or this is not our culture. So how do you sort of domesticate the human rights?
And what are it's not easy and it's very sensitive. I remember once in the UN Working Group on Indigenous Populations, the Aborigines from Australia were complaining about the white man's justice. Locking Aborigines, who are basically nomads, up in the white man's prison for 10 or 20 years equaled death sentence, and indeed the Aboriginal suicide rate in prisons was much higher. the UN experts in this meeting all tended to agree, but then they asked the abolitionists, what, how would you deal with it? If a person, Aboriginal person is convicted of a crime, what is your punishment replacing the imprisonment? And they said, spearing. Our traditional punishment for murder is spearing.
What's that?
You put the person up against the wall and you throw a spear at them.
In the body?
You aim at the body. You may miss and then you escape. You may maim and hurt them and you may kill them. That's sort of traditional justice. And here all the UN experts in this meeting, there are high international experts in the UN Working Group on Indigenous Population, they all agreed that spearing was actually more inhuman and more cruel punishment than the imprisonment. And this issue has come up a lot of times. The indigenous and minorities will say, we have not been involved in drafting of your standards. You are imposing on us foreign concepts and alien ideas. But the UN response has been pretty consistent. When there is a clash between human rights that enjoy white acceptance on the one side and cultural traditions on the other side, human rights will prevail. You've seen it with regard to children, where some religions do not allow them to go to hospital or receive medical care. The UN has said the best interest of the child shall prevail, and the state can remove the child and take it to the hospital, even against the culture of the group involved. Female circumcision or mutilation is another example, where the UN has said the culture shall not prevail, the human rights, the integrity of the person shall prevail. So there are a number of examples that UN said human rights takes priority, but there may be grey areas, and I'm sure there are still questions that remain to be answered in this category. But I do think you can see a certain trend towards prevalence of human rights over cultural traditions, provided they run counter to some of the human rights standards.
My name is Nicola Chukum. I'm a Roma lawyer dealing with litigation at the Chancellor Children Foundation in Hungary. We are dealing with good schools where we found segregated education in public education. It's a pretty hard topic for us at least to implement our judgments at the courts. And as you mentioned, there is a big lack of monitoring. And my question is just about if you have any opinion or recommendation in the monitoring system or the tools or methods, what could be used during human rights litigation or education.
Again, no easy answer. I'm a believer in litigation myself. Whenever you can establish clear patterns or practices of discrimination, you very likely have a court case you can proceed with. And if you don't prevail with a court case at the national level, you now have international appeals procedures that you can pursue. Not only with the European organizations, but also with the UN, the Human Rights Committee under the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. That can also extend to education because of Article 27, Equality Before the Law, has a very good record of finding in favor of minorities. So, I mean, you do have avenues of appeal beyond the national scope. But I believe litigation should also be combined with research. You need to find areas where discrimination is taking place. I remember visiting Aboriginal communities in Australia. It reminds me of something you were saying yesterday from Romania. We were visiting Aboriginal communities within driving distance from Sydney. you drove on white on asphalt roads, excellent conditions, and you came to a small white town, and then the asphalt road ended, and you drove to a much bigger black town, where there was very little infrastructure, not only no asphalt roads, but no sewage, no hospital, which was in a smaller, wider town, but a nursing station in a black town. I mean, if you can establish statistics of this kind of discrimination, and you need to establish it thoroughly, beyond doubt, and document it, and I'll tell you, you have court cases, and they can now be taken international as well. And you have now all these monitoring going on by charter-based monitoring in the UN. It's not binding on states, whatever comes there in terms of recommendations, but it has very often serious embarrassment value for states. States do not like to be blacklisted by special rapporteurs and so on. And you have the big NGOs. I'm convinced I have heard government people tell me they do not like it when Amnesty International or Human Rights Watch targets them for violations. But you also have to lobby these big NGOs. They are swamped with incoming information about violations and problems around the globe. So you need to do the research for them also and bring these problems to their attention and lobby them for doing something about it. So there are plentiful of avenues that can be pursued. The court avenue, the litigation, is particularly attractive in my mind, because at least in many countries, the courts are independent of government, because you do have international appeals if you fail at the national level, and because court decisions are binding. Go for it. Good luck. Good luck.
I have questions. No one has. Yes, I always have questions. Gudmundur, you mentioned, I find it very interesting that there are national, that's national legislation on human rights education. Can you tell us some examples? Is this in constitutional law? Or where is there a specific legislation on this? I don't think in Hungary there is legislation on human rights education.
Usually you find legislation on human rights education in the form of provisions in general legislation on education. Or you find human rights education has been introduced into national curricula for countries as a whole, then adopted as regulations or decrees by the Ministry of Education and so on. I'm not aware of a single country today, but then this declaration from 2011 is very recent. I'm not aware of a single country that has specifically adopted legislation on human rights education per se. I believe it's important because you need to reach private schools. In many countries you have private schools. They have to be told by law to do these things. But I think it's also a necessary message to the administrators of other schools, public schools, that this is something they have to pay attention to.
And then I have another question, if it's possible. Now I hope I'm not abusing my position here, but I would be interested. So you have this vast experience in making international norms on indigenous rights and minority rights. You stood behind the Lund recommendations, and you were very, very critical about the Framework Convention for the protection of national minorities when this has come into place. Well, much the Lund recommendation were 99, so there was a 10-year-old review meeting in Lund in 2009. But looking back to this minority rights, 25 years of minority rights at an international level. Where do we stand now? In Europe, elsewhere, have we made progress in terms of norms and their implementation? Are we stuck? How could you give us a...
You realize this is a 1 hour question.
Yes.
There's an optimistic way to look at this question, and there is a pessimistic way to look at this question. The optimistic approach is, we do have quite a lot of good international standards on minority rights, most notably in widely ratified treaties, like the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the Convention on Elimination of Racial Discrimination, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the UNESCO Convention Against Discrimination in Education. There are some very good texts. I published a few years ago a compilation of international standards on minority rights, and I think it had 64 texts in there, both global and regional. So we do have standards. We have some good monitoring going on. The Human Rights Committee has adopted some 20 decisions on minority rights, most of them favorable to minorities. The European Court of Human Rights in recent years has done a couple of positive decisions on minority rights, although their problem is that the convention doesn't have a minority rights clause, and courts tend to be conservative. So there are some reasons for optimism. The pessimistic approach would say governments remain as reluctant as ever when it comes to minority rights. The framework convention you mentioned from the Council of Europe is a shame. I wrote an article published in the International Journal of Minority Group Rights in 2001. Since I wrote that article, I'm not invited to a single Council of Europe meeting on minorities. I'm blacklisted. That's fine. Saying that the Framework Convention fell below standards that have been adopted at the UN, both in terms of substance and in terms of monitoring. No complaints available. And today, the Framework Convention continues to go down the hill. The Advisory Committee under the Framework Convention is transforming it from an instrument on minority rights into some sort of multiculturalism approach to everybody who doesn't belong to the majority population, be they immigrants or refugees or what have you. And I think eventually that will result in watering down of or diluting minority rights, and it's very unfortunate. The same reluctance is felt at the UN. The mechanisms you have for minority rights at the UN have been weakened. There used to be a working group on minorities which could adopt resolutions and met for 5 days. It was replaced by a forum that cannot adopt resolutions and meets for 2 days, and so on. You have an independent expert on minority issues. It comes under special procedures. But all the other mechanisms in special procedures, they are called special rapporteurs. And they have a mandate to look into investigations. The independent expert on minority issues is not called a rapporteur, has a mandate to do research, not to report on violations, and the ultimate shame is that it's not an expert on minority rights, it's an expert on minority issues within the human rights program. So everything is done to water it down. The first independent expert on this mandate, Gay McDougall, an African-American, was very strong, and she ignored the limitations. Unfortunately now, the mandate seems to be slowing down or losing flight, so to say, but maybe it's too early to say.